In preparation for his debate against the atheist Michael Martin, Greg Bahnsen prepared a lecture about the history of philosophy and why atheism simply cannot give us a rational account of human knowledge. He said, "It is my conviction that atheism as a philosophy makes it impossible to achieve this goal of knowing anything. Human beings seek to understand themselves and the world in which they live to make their experience intelligible. With knowledge, people gain control over their environment, which makes their lives more comfortable and safe. As a person becomes more intellectually mature, he brings discipline to the area of study that interests him. He seeks greater precision, coherence, and clarity in his thought. This scientific level of understanding to those various aspects of experience is never an end for human inquiry. Such questions will inevitably arise out of the nature, extent, and assumptions of science, especially about the relationship between the different sciences. This brings us to the consideration of philosophy. Philosophy is concerned with the presuppositions that arise in any field of study. It seeks a world and life view in terms of which all the elements of human experience can be unified into a single coherent outlook. Philosophy has a critical function and a constructive function on the other. It seeks to cross-examine claims to the truth and create a unified picture of reality. Philosophy forces us to think about questions about the nature of reality, how we know what we know, and how man ought to behave." So philosophy will ask the following four questions. 1. What are the ultimate principles by which we answer philosophical questions about reality, knowledge, and ethics? What are the principles that render experience intelligible? Are the principles logically consistent? Are they explicable in a language? And are they justifiable or just arbitrary? 2. How shall we understand nature? Is there any underlying unity through change and the way things appear in the world? Is there an objective order to the world? And if so, is it purposeful? 3. What is man's place and function in the world? Does man have dignity? What is the meaning of life? And how do values fit into the realm of nature? And 4. Is man's mind self-sufficient? Is reason an instrument for painting objective knowledge about reality? Should man follow his observations or rational conceptions? How do senses and reasoning relate to each other? Everyone utilizes some network of presuppositions regarding these matters. Philosophy forces a critical investigation of differing worldviews. Why is it that philosophers don't come to an agreement on these basic issues? There are profound differences between the worldviews of those who are disputing. Those worldviews will control which way in which factual evidence is accepted and interpreted. Thus, these disputes are not resolvable by simply observing the world. Conflicting presuppositions about reality, knowledge, and ethics determine what a person takes to be problematic, and what can be taken for granted about experience, and what kind of method to follow. Adherents to different worldviews argue past each other and come to radically different conclusions. Any fruitful debate over the philosophical question of the existence of God will come down to an assessment of conflicting worldviews. In the end, the issue is whether underlying philosophy regarding reality, knowledge, and ethics is cogent, consistent, and warranted. In particular, we must ask whether atheism or Christian theism can provide the preconditions for making human experience intelligible, or whether they leave science, ethics, and logic to the arbitrary and/or incoherent. It is just because the atheist worldview undermines the rationality and morality that it is philosophically unacceptable. What we all take for granted in terms of objective knowledge, linguistic meaningfulness, logical standards, scientific procedures, human freedom and dignity, and moral absolutes. Because what we take for granted in terms of those things would be utterly unintelligible within the context of the atheist worldview. These things do not comport with atheistic presuppositions. When the atheist tells us there is no God, and that all there is matter and motion, it becomes impossible to give a rational account of objectivity, human freedom, moral absolutes, science, laws of logic, etc. On the other hand, the worldview of Christian theism is the philosophical perspective in which all of those things are intelligible. The atheist who attempts to use those things to refute Christianity is assuming the very thing he's attempting to refute. Anti-theism presupposes theism. The proof of Christian theism is that without it, you cannot prove anything. The atheist worldview does not comport with the concepts and principles of logic, science, language, human freedom, etc. It cannot prove or give an account of anything. Atheism fails as a worldview and profoundly refutes itself. the atheist cannot know anything whatsoever. You will find that in response to their inability to give an account for human experience, they will dismiss the questions of worldviews and consider it unimportant. The one thing the atheist knows for certain to begin with is that God is not going to be allowed to exist. If the atheist needs the existence of God to have a credible worldview, then it would be better just to say they don't need worldviews. It's just because the atheist worldview cannot provide the preconditions for intelligibility that the atheist worldview makes it impossible to argue for the atheist worldview. It's not just that the atheist cannot prove that God does not exist. The atheist can't account for anything. God has made his existence and character clear to all men. The evidence of God's existence is pervasive and inescapable. Because God's existence is the precondition for the intelligibility of man's experience, those who deny God are thinking foolish. I'd like to illustrate this point with some philosophers from the past. They were committed to a rigorously empirical theory of knowledge. The attempt to develop this kind of outlook has always proved unsuccessful and self-refuting. Epicurus, for example, was born in 341 BC and was a materialistic atomist in his metaphysic. He was a qualitative hedonist in his ethics. He held that philosophical method should begin with the plain facts of sense perception and shape all opinions in terms of these perceptions, augmented by the demand for non-contradiction. Following Democritus, there is no such thing as spiritual reality, for reality is composed of an infinite number of qualitatively identical and self-propelling atoms, whose arrangements and motion explains the qualities of things and their behaviors. Everything that exists, even the gods and the human soul, are explained materially and naturalistically. The problem is that the premise that all knowledge is perceptual in nature is not one that Epicurus knew on the basis of perception itself. Thus, his philosophy refutes itself. Everything is known by perception according to him. Does he know this on the basis of perception? Secondly, what Epicurus said about reality could not possibly have been known by means of perception. He believed in the existence of imperceptible bits of matter, but he did not know this by perception. He believed that these bits of matter were infinite, but he didn't have infinite perception of everything. These infinite bits of matter were in ceaseless motion, but how could he know that? He would have to be watching them all the time. On the one hand, he wanted to be strictly empirical, but the empiricism undermined what he wanted to say about reality. Thirdly, his naturalistic, atomistic theory of reality could not explain men as having free will, since man is nothing but the mechanical combinations of atoms falling through empty space. He offered a theory that there must have been a swerve in the fall of these atoms, which account for man's unpredictability, which we call man's will. For some reason, one atom swerved and caused a billiard ball effect, and this is what brings humans free will. Even this deprives man of purposeful choice and leaves us with the conclusion that since our brains are mechanically determined by the swerves of atoms, we therefore have no basis for trusting our reasoning. If we can't help but think what we do, why bother with philosophical investigation in the first place? Fourthly, how could Epicurus know that there was no afterlife? How did he know it through sense perception? It doesn't seem likely. David Hume, the Scottish skeptic, was born in 1711. He had a strictly empirical method and anti-metaphysical prejudices. Hume advanced a strictly empirical criterion of meaning. He said, "When we entertain, therefore, any suspicion that a philosophical term is employed without any meaning or idea, we need but inquire from what impression is that supposed idea derived. This kind of rigor would lead us to take into the hand any volume of divinity or school of metaphysics, for instance. Let us ask, does it contain any abstract reasoning concerning quantity or number? No. Does it contain any experimental reasoning concerning the matter and fact of existence? No. Commit it then to the flames, for it can contain nothing but sophistry and illusion." A cautious philosophy will note that the outcome of a consistent application of Hume's empirical method, from which Hume did not flinch, is that our common philosophical notions, for all their use and importance, prove to be false and nonsensical. We have no empirical impression of any underlying identity through change, either in the supposed objects of the external world or in the selves as the subject of these sense impressions. There is nothing but temporal succession of one sensation after another. There is no meaningful basis for speaking of continuous objects of experience, nor any meaningful basis of speaking for a continuous I who experiences illusory subjects. Hume said, "I am nothing more than a loose bundle of perceptions." Even here, he had no warrant for speaking of these loose perceptions being bundles, since there was no empirical impression of such a bundle. According to Hume, there could be no evidence that would justify our practical belief in an external world whatsoever. He said, "The mind has never anything present to it but the perceptions, and cannot possibly reach the experience of the connection with objects. The supposition of that connection is therefore without any foundation in reasoning." Hume means that all are caught in an egocentric predicament. because we can never see any connection between our impressions in our mind and objects in the world, and therefore we can't even say that there is a rational foundation for believing in an external world. Furthermore, argued Hume, the idea that there is a causal connection between any two events, despite the fact that it embodies the underlying belief of all empirical science, is likewise without any rational foundation. While you may experience a succession of events, you never perceive a necessary or causal connection between the events that you experience. Hume said we can never observe any tie between them. In this case, science can only report past observations to us, and every event to us is a brand new event about which nothing can be rationally said by way of induction, inference, or future prediction. Hume's strict empiricism landed us into utter skepticism by his own admission. Hume's philosophy led to skepticism about God, the external world, the existence of the self, and all scientific reasoning. Even Hume's attempts to explain why humans engage in inductive reasoning, he said, by force of natural instinct or habit, they do this regardless of rational justification. Even this attempt rests on the validity of the inductive reference, now about human nature and about the alleged workings of human minds and habits. Furthermore, any attempt to mitigate Hume's skepticism by turning toward a pragmatic interest in action and problem-solving rather than in the theoretical demands of a philosophy is not only a philosophical cop-out, but it rests upon the premise of experience and regularities in the behavior and nature of man, from which generalizations are allowed to be made into successful plans of action. Even the pragmatic attempt to deal with Hume's skepticism rests upon the very regularity of nature, in which Hume's philosophy rules out as illegitimate. Hume's anti-metaphysical empiricism proved to destroy any objectivity, rationality, and science. Bertrand Russell was born in 1872 and died in 1970. He believed that logical rigor can entangle the puzzles of philosophy. He recommended that philosophy adapt the methods of science, believing that methods of science can yield truths about things which, contrary to pragmatism, resides in correspondence to their atomic facts of experience and not merely to the workability of our beliefs. He said that we should look with skepticism and doubt upon anything that is not susceptible to scientific analysis and proof. Russell hoped that his logical analysis could surmount the problems of David Hume and make it possible to validate inferences from our momentary sense data to the world of physics or to the objects of common sense realism that are known by description. He thought that we could objectively save scientific knowledge about an object of the external world. He said, I wanted, on the one hand, to find out whether anything could be known. According to him, the business of philosophy was to give a general description of the whole universe, an inventory of all the kinds of entities that make up the world in which we live. Russell said, there is only one constant preoccupation. I have throughout been anxious to discover how much we can be said to know and with what degree of certainty or doubtfulness. He was forced to conclude that most of what passes for knowledge is open to reasonable doubt. He wanted to know how our knowledge is possible and how do we know that anything exists. He wanted to use logical analysis to answer these questions. He said every philosophical problem, when it is subjected to the necessary analysis and purification, is found either to be not really philosophical at all or else logical. Ordinary language is so incoherent that it despises the logical form of what we are trying to say and badly misleads philosophers. Russell wanted to develop a pure language which will picture the world so that every sentence will correspond to a fact or group of facts in the world. And every word would correspond to an element of a fact. Every word would then refer to a thing, property, or relation. The perfect language would then consist of the report of momentary sense experiences. Only that which can be translated into this perfect language is therefore knowable. He thought that the mind, material objects, universals, particulars, laws of logic and time belong in the inventory of what is real. He said, as instances, I might mention mind, matter, consciousness, knowledge, experience, causality, will, time. I believe all these notions to be inexact and approximate, essentially infected with vagueness, incapable of forming part of any exact science. Throughout his career, Russell changed his mind many times about what sorts of things that belong in the inventory of the universe. Subsequently, he dropped the material objects and mind. Particulars were replaced by qualities. The only universal he had sympathy for was the universal called similarity. Basic to Russell's thinking was that distinction between what we know by acquaintance, that's experience, and what we know by description. In other words, there is a distinction between hard data and soft data. Russell said, I still hold that any proposition other than a tautology, if it's true, is true in virtue of being related to a fact, and that facts in general are independent of experience. He said that there is a possibility of sensing something, and that independent of what is actually sensed, and everything that is real is made up of those possible perceptions. The key problem with Russell is, can we infer from our direct experience, from our sense data, or the possibilities of sense data, those entities of common sense that we describe in the world? He said, can the existence of anything other than our own hard data be inferred from the existence of those data? He said, if we know what can only be experienced and verified, then most of what passes for knowledge is not knowledge at all. Russell had to admit to failure at the end of his career. The problem was to show that inferences from hard data to soft data can be warranted, and empiricism is the outcome of the atheist development of a worldview, to attempt to show that knowledge is possible. He said, although our postulates can be fitted into a framework which has what may be called empiricist flavor, it remains undeniable that our knowledge of them, insofar as we do know them, cannot be based upon experience. In this sense, it must be admitted, empiricism as a theory of knowledge has proven inadequate, though less so than any previous theory of knowledge. Russell said, science is at war with itself when it most means to be objective. It finds itself plunged into subjectivity against its will. Naive realism leads to physics, and physics, if true, shows that naive realism is false. Therefore, naive realism, if true, is false, and therefore it's false. An objective knowledge of the external world that realism supposedly gives is destroyed by empiricism. He said, in ontology, I start by accepting the truth of physics. Philosophers may say, what justification do you have for accepting the truth of physics? I reply, merely a common sense basis. I believe in the world of physics as well as in the world of psychology. If we are to hold that we know anything of the external world, we must accept the canons of scientific knowledge. Whether an individual decides to accept or reject these canons is purely a personal affair and not subject to argument. Ludwig Wittgenstein, in his work, we see the culmination of Russell's work to use logical analysis to solve philosophical problems. He held that since we can make assertions about the world if we examine the logic of our assertions, that will disclose the general features that the world must have for any assertion about it to be true. In other words, we can, by logical analysis, determine what can be said about the world. He said the correct method in philosophy would really be the following, to say nothing except what can be said. That would be propositions of natural science. That would be something that has nothing to do with philosophy. And then whenever someone else wanted to say something metaphysical to demonstrate to him that he had failed to give meaning to certain signs and propositions. Wittgenstein said, most of the propositions and questions to be found in philosophical words are not false, but are nonsensical. Consequently, we cannot give any answer to questions of this kind, but can only point out that they are nonsensical. Most of the propositions and questions of philosophers rise from our failure to understand the logic of language. This approach had a major difficulty. If Wittgenstein's purification of language was going to be rigorous as he supposed, then it would turn out that the very language that he used in the Tractatus was meaningless. At the end of the Tractatus, he said, my propositions serve as elucidations in the following way. Anyone who understands me eventually recognizes them as nonsensical. When he has used them as steps to climb up and through on them, over them, to throw up the ladder after he's climbed up it. These are the very defects that would prevent atheists from making a philosophically cogent case for atheism, and would then leave them with no place to refute Christianity. In comparison of worldviews, atheism would be refuted by its own internal flaws, particularly its inability to provide the preconditions for the intelligibility of any human experience. Nietzsche said, I am afraid we are not rid of God because we still have faith in grammar. As long as we are still committed to universals, to rules, to standards, and to the possibility of communication, we are still holding on to God. Deconstructionism, in our modern age, is much closer to being sincere in following our atheism to its bitter end. There is no point to debate when there is no objective truth or meaning to communicate and defend. If atheistic presuppositions are correct, then man has no mental intellectual freedom to even assess evidence and choose truth. If atheistic presuppositions are correct, there would be no universals of logic, no linguistic meaning. If his atheist presuppositions were correct, there are no rational bases for scientific inductive inference or for the uniformity of nature. If atheistic presuppositions are correct, there is no continuing identity of objects, no personal identity in the self, no basis for trusting memories, no similarity relation, no sets, no numbers, no concepts, no laws. If atheistic presuppositions are correct, there's no such thing as an objective, moral obligation, or even an obligation to be logical. An atheist cannot reason, communicate, and prove their atheism. This is why I said at the beginning that Christian theism has proved from the impossibility of the contrary. It is only within the Christian worldview that the precondition of rationality in debates can be offered. Christian theism has a transcendental necessity. It alone provides a worldview that is the precondition for the intelligibility of man's experience, his knowledge, and his conduct.